Good morning, members. It is the appointed time and we have a quorum. I call to order the meeting of the Bills Committee on Advanced Decision on Life-Sustaining Treatment Bill. We will now invite the administration to come in. Members are reminded that since the previous meeting, two sets of papers were issued by the Secretariat. At the previous meeting, we were scrutinizing the bill up to Clause 29 of the Chinese text. When the administration is ready, will the Deputy Secretary brief us on the replies of the administration? There being none, are there any questions from the members? If that's the case, we will resume scrutinizing the bill. We are at Clause 30, Requirements for Signing Registered Medical Practitioners. That's page 3331 of the English text of the bill. Now, will the legal advisor please remind members of the legal issues during the process? Administration, please. Thank you, Chair, and good morning, members. As mentioned by the Chair, we are now at C3330 of the Chinese text, Clause 30. Now, whether this is a DNA CPR based on AMD or non-AMD based DNA CPR, besides requiring two registered medical practitioners to sign the form, one of the signing RMP must be a specialist. Both signing RMPs or registered medical practitioners must not be an interest holder of the subjects. This is Clause 30. They must not be an interested person of the subject's patient of the DNA CPR order. Please continue. Clause 31, Subdivision 2 on Revocation of Order. C3332 of the Chinese text. Under certain situations, conditions, revocation of DNA CPR order is possible. Now, when the underlying AMD of the order is revoked, then naturally the DNA CPR order would also be revoked. Clause 32, subclause 2, there are certain conditions for the AMD-based DNA CPR order to be revoked. Now, for the DNA CPR order issued against a person who is not of age, when the person is of age, it would be revoked. There are also DNA CPR which is issued to persons who are of age but are mentally incompetent. So when the person is no longer mentally incompetent, the order would be revoked. And also, Clause 32 mentions ways to revoke the DNA CPR order. Now, like AMD, to revoke a DNA CPR order, the subject's person can express in writing their wish. Or make a verbal indication to revoke the DNA CPR as witnessed by one or more adults. Now, unlike AMD, DNA CPR orders are issued based on the clinical judgments of doctors. So there is an exception. when a RMP and a RMP who is a specialist decide to revoke the order, it can also be revoked. Now it says one registered medical practitioner who is a specialist and another RMP, whether a specialist or not. So it takes two doctors to revoke the order, one of them being specialist, correct. On signing and on revocation of the NACPR order, this is the same requirement. Now please move on. Now we are now at Division 3, C3334, effective period of the NACPR order. So there is a date on which it begins, and also there is an ending date. That is when the order is revoked, or if it is not so revoked, on the expiry of the date specified in the order on the schedule by a doctor. So when we come to the form, you will see the column. Now the validity period of the DNACPR order will not exceed 12 months. That's specified on the form as well. We will come to that later. Bear in mind that such an order is a clinical judgment. If the validity period is too long, it would undermine the interests of the patient. So regularly, the doctor must revisit the situation of the patient. Concerning renewal of the NACPR order, in subsections 2, 3, and 4, there are provisions providing for the renewal of the DNACPR order administratively. Bracket 5 says that for a DNACPR order made for a person who is under the age of 18 years, the expiry date must fall before the person's 18th birthday. That is a reasonable arrangement. Just a moment, a member has pressed the button, Ms. Lillian Kwok. Thank you, Chair. I would like to clarify on a few points. Mr. Lee said the renewal would take place annually. Assuming that a patient becomes vegetative or patient falls into a vegetative state, and it straddles across the expiry date, the patient is in sort of a coma. So for these situations, how will you deal with it? Will the DNACPR order be revoked at once? May I invite Dr. Chair to answer? Dr. Doris Chair. Now, the validity period should not exceed 1 year. However, a doctor can also renew the order before the expiry date. Usually, that packs with the consultation appointment. So, usually, it would not be renewed on the date of expiry. The renewal of the DNACPR order only requires the signature from one RMP to confirm that the situation of the patient is still applicable. So renewal is not a big issue. And for DNACPR order, the patients themselves do not have to sign it. As long as there is an AMD in effect refusing CPR treatment, then the doctor can renew the DNACPR order without the patient's signature. Simply put, for patients in vegetative state, they may be in that state for years. For AMD signed previously, the doctor can simply renew the DNA CPR order themselves. Thank you. Please continue. Thank you, Chair. We are now at clause 34. DNA CPR order is similar to an AMD in concept. So a DNA CPR order must be valid and applicable. So that the relevant obligations and liabilities relating to the procedure would apply. Now, unless otherwise specified, the DNA CPR order would be valid for in certain circumstances. Now, these exceptional cases include A. None of the treatment providers or rescuers has notice of the order as described, or any of the conditions mentioned in Section 26 is not met. C. The making of the order was procured by wrongful means. D. The effective period of the order has ended. So bar these situations, the order would apply. Concerning the applicability of a DNA CPR order, it is similar to AMD as well. Clause 36, 1 and 3. Now, this is similar to Clause 14 concerning the applicability of AMD. Now, for DNA CPR order, the contents are the same. It's just the textual differences. Now, subclause 1. If the RMP anticipated the circumstance at the time, it would be likely that he or she would not have made the order, then that would be a condition. Now, if you remember, for underlying AMD, it is important. However, DNA CPR, this is a clinical judgment. So under subclause 2, there is a different reference compared with the AMD. That is when the attending RMP, so that may be an RMP other than the signing RMP, made the diagnosis or prognosis that the patient needs a CPR. But if the judgment is different from that of the signing RMP, and there is and the RMP reasonably considers that it would be likely that the signing RMP would not have made the order or extended the effective period of the DNA CPR had the signing RMP made the same diagnosis or prognosis, then this DNA CPR order is not applicable. Now, for not AMD-based DNA CPR made for a person who is mentally incompetent or not of age, if the attending RMP notices special circumstances that by not following the DNA CPR order, it would be in the best interest of the patient, then the order will not be applicable. So these are some extra flexibilities offered for the doctors. Ms. Lillian Kwok, thank you. So Mr. Lee covered clauses 35 and 36 together. So 35, what about wrongful means? What do you mean by wrongful, procured by wrongful means? Now 36.4, exceptional circumstance that warrants disregarding the order. What do you mean? Can you give us some examples?
All right, let me try to explain what wrongful means are. When we look at page C3274, under definition, there is a definition about wrongful means. That is, it include coercion or kind of a wrongful method. And for exceptional circumstances, this is a kind of a blanket circumstance that is under which the RMP could consider all factors available. He would also consider what is would be in the best interest of the patient. And this attending RMP will have the right to disregard the order. That is, for instance, when the order is was signed, but then in the clinical situation, a lot of people disagree to that, including family members of the patient and also attending doctors. So if the RMP has doubt about it, so these are the exceptional circumstances that warrants disregarding of the order. Thank you. The reason why I point out wrongful means is because when you are talking about about page 3274, there are definition about wrongful means. For instance, deception, fraud, misrepresentation, harassment, coercion, or undue influence. But if the RMP really find that there are some criminal offense could be involved, will the RMP, should the RMP be responsible to report the case? Thank you for the question. We actually have considered this situation. For instance, the RMP might notice, or if there are misrepresentation, this could involve a criminal offense. So on page C3364, we will have clauses further mentioning about the results of misrepresentation or deception. All right, next, Mr. Chen Puileng. Thanks. I'd like to ask about Section 36.2b, that is, if the RMP considers that the signing RMP would not have made the order or extended its effective period. Well, if the attending RMP revokes the order when his view is in contrast with the signing doctor, that is previously the doctor who previously signed or co-signed the RMP, then this attending doctor would have the right to revoke the order. But then, would there be dispute? That is, how can the attending RMP be sure that his judgment is correct when his judgment is actually in contrast with the previous RMP who signed the order? All right, let me perhaps explain it briefly, and Dr. Zhou could supplement. In clause 2 and 4 of section 36, it provides the situation that the clinical situation or the condition of the patient may change after some time. So we provide the power to the attending RMP to consider the latest situation of the patient so that he could make a decision that is in the best interest of the patient. even though that decision may be in contravention with the previous RMP who signed the order for the patient. Dr. Zhe Chenyan, I think we have to talk about the underlying principles first. That is, a doctor who made a clinical decision, whether it is a treatment decision, this would not be binding on the following doctor or another RMP who would be attending the patient in the future. So each RMP would have the right to make his own professional decision according to the latest condition of the patient. So the attending RMP might see the order there, it's valid, but then he would consider all other factors, including the latest condition of the patient. He should make his own professional decision at that point of time. So actually, that is the reason why we need two medical doctors to co-sign the DMACPR order. Well, there could be exceptional circumstances. For instance, the AMD prescribed that he already has a terminal illness, and so he signed a DMACPR. But then the new attending doctor, when treating the patient, he might see that the patient is actually perhaps recovering, even though this patient may be suffering from a terminal illness. But then there are some progress. So this new attending RMP could make his own professional judgment to see what would be in the best interest of the patient. So we give the flexibility to the attending RMP. He could make his own professional judgment with all the latest situation arising. But of course, he has to be very cautious. The latest attending doctor must consider all factors available. He should also write down the reasons why he disagreed with the previous RMP who signed the order, and stating all the reasons why he would revoke the order and why he thinks that this would be in the best interest of the doctor. Of course, if time allows, this RMP could go and consult the previous RMP who signed the order. But then if it doesn't allow, if he doesn't have that kind of time, the luxury of time, then he could make his own clinical and professional decision. All right, but then, well, when the order was signed, it was co-signed by two RMP, but then at this clinical, at this moment, it would be revoked by only one RMP. Would that be a problem? Well, if it is revoked, you need two doctors. But then it's not revoking the DNACPR order. It's just stating that this is not applicable. Of course, if the order needs to be revoked, there should be the co-signing of two doctors. However, what we're talking now is an emergency case, and the attending doctor believes that disregarding the order would be in the best interest of the patient, and then he could make his professional decision on his own. So only one RMP would be required. All right, I'd like to seek clarification on one point. For instance, if the DNACPR is going to expire, there would need one RMP to renew. But then if that doctor is of the view that it should not be reviewed, does it mean that there would need two doctors to refuse the renewal of the order? All right. Please turn to clause 33.1. When it is revoked under section 31, or if it is not revoked, it's on the expiry of the date specified in the order. Well, what I meant was if there is an RMP who is attending the patient. He is not a specialist, but then after considering the clinical situations, he is of the view that the order should not be renewed. Well, does it mean that, well, in that case, the order would naturally be expired? Well, would that be a loophole? Because there would not have two RMPs inspecting the situation and to make a decision on whether it should be renewed or not. Well, the family members of the patient could find another RMP who is willing to renew the order. Dr. Lam is correct. That is, if there is no other doctors who would agree to renew the order, then the order would naturally go naturally become expired. But if the family members insist that this order should be renewed, then they could find another doctor who is willing to co-sign or to sign the order so that it could be renewed. What about if the order is expired? That is, after a year, would they need to do it all over again? That is, to start signing a new order? That is, to look for one specialist and another RMP so as to make a new order? That is correct. If it is expired, that means the order is not valid anymore. So they would need another new order. That is, all the processes should have the members, family members, should go through all the processes in order to make a new order for the patient. Next, Reverend Kun. Chair, I understand the administration has a lot of safety arrangement. But then I want to go back to a question. If there are so many hurdles, would the wish of the patient be protected? Of course, now you want to play safe. You have to have two doctors, one a specialist, another doctor, so as to co-sign the order. And if it is revoked, you also need a doctor to sign it. But then I think the principle or underlying rationale of the order is to protect the interests of the patient. If we have so many hurdles, so many protection procedures, would the genuine interests of the patient be taken care of? All right. Just now I mentioned about a situation that is a new attending RMP finds that the order previously signed by another doctor does not apply, or there are new clinical situations arising, so he thinks that the order is not really relevant. So, in that case, it doesn't mean that this attending doctor is not considering the best interest of the patient. As I mentioned just now, I cited an example. A cancer patient, terminally ill, and then previously he signed an order. But then the new attending order finds that even though this patient is still suffering from cancer, he is not terminally ill. There may be new situations arising. There might be a new treatment in the market. So this new attending RMP finds that there are some hope for treatment or the curing of the patient. So he thinks that the order should be revoked. So that means the AMD is not applicable yet in the view of the new attending RMP. So under this situation, he could make his own professional decision and ignore the DNA CPR order. That is actually exactly taking care of the interests of the patient. Well, Chairman, that would be very confusing. Well, each doctor may have his or her own judgment, a professional judgment. Very often we would go to seek for a second opinion, because we know that different doctors may have different opinions and different judgments, which sometimes might be conflicting. I actually have a family member who had been diagnosed as terminally ill, but then when this family member returned to Hong Kong, he sought a second opinion, and actually he could live on for two or three more years. Well, in that case, that will be very confusing because different RMP may have different views.
Deputy Secretary, the basis of the entire arrangement is to respect patients' will. Now, the scope of DNA CPR order is rather narrow. It is confined to the performance of CPR treatment. For AMD, when the patient is still mentally capable, they can designate certain life-sustaining treatments that they will refuse. However, for DNA CPR order, inoperability, it involves clinical cause. That is whether the patient still fulfills the requirements, that is, having a terminal illness or a serious irreversible disease and so on. So these rely on the clinical judgments of the doctor. In terms of operability, the scope is very narrow. So that's why a doctor must be involved to make a clinical judgment. For life-sustaining treatments, there is a wider scope of safeguards. So each RMP must be held accountable for their clinical judgments, and there must be ample records justifying the judgment. So for DNA CPR order revocation, there are three conditions. Clinically speaking, it would be unlikely that another doctor has a second opinion. There are clear medical definitions for the diagnosis. So as mentioned by Dr. Jie, the clinical judgments made by the attending RMP would be a threshold. Dr. Jie, besides DNA CPR, for directions on an AMD to reject other life-sustaining treatment, it would also be subject to these conditions. For example, if a patient indicates that they would refuse a certain kind of life-sustaining treatment when they are terminally ill, it also requires the clinical judgment from an RMP to decide whether the cancer is at a terminal stage, so that the AMD's directive should be complied with. Or, a doctor may say that despite the patient's cancer condition, it is still not at a terminal stage. So before that stage, the doctors would not follow the directives on the AMD because the AMD is not applicable yet. So that's a clinical call. So the clinical judgment must be supported by guidelines and medical expertise. So in most cases, there would not be a conflict between the clinical judgments made by various doctors. For the rare case where there is a dispute, if a doctor thinks that life-sustaining treatments should be performed or CPR should be performed, then we would adopt the if in doubt, save life first principle and give the patients the life-sustaining treatment. When doctors agree that the patient is at a terminal stage, then the patient's will must be respected. Reverend Kuhn, I understand the rationale, but I am unsure about the operability of this order. Now, objectively, there is a robust threshold on making the order. There is one specialist and one non-specialist RMP. When the order is performed, you only need one doctor to decide, and maybe that doctor is inexperienced or revocation. It only requires one doctor. So it seems that on revocation, the threshold is much more relaxed. On making the order, it takes two doctors and one must be a specialist. On revocation, only one doctor is required. Mr. Eddie Lee, Deputy Secretary, we follow Reverend Kuhn's suggestion. However, on DNA CPR, the situations of the patients would change over time. On entering the order, on signing or making of the order, the RMPs would have regarded that the patients have fulfilled certain conditions. However, the conditions of the patients may change. If the attending doctor thinks that the patients no longer fulfill the requirements, then there must be a mechanism in place to allow the doctor to deviate from the DNA CPR order based on their clinical judgment. If there is not an exit mechanism, the patients may end up losing their life. So we must balance that against the will of the patients. In principle, we would follow the will of the patients, but there must be a mechanism to cater for changes in circumstances which render the order invalid. Let me follow up on Reverend Kuhn's question. Sometimes the doctor on duty will be different. So today, the doctor on duty thinks the patient is not in the terminal stage yet, but the doctor on duty the next day thinks that the patient is already terminally ill or at a terminal stage. So it may cause confusion. For these cases, who should make the judgment? Today, the doctor decides that DNA CPR should not be performed. The next day, the doctor thinks otherwise. So I think Peter Kuhn's question is very realistic. As we mentioned, at the very least, the validity of the order will not be affected. It's just about operability. So may I defer to Dr. Doris Chair? Thank you. There are two types of DNA CPR. We are now talking about AMD-based DNA CPR order. For these cases, the patient's wish has been indicated clearly. For non-AMD-based DNA CPR, two doctors would make an assessment considering the best interest of the patient. Now, for AMD-based DNA CPR order, whether the doctor would comply with the DNA CPR order depends on two factors. One, validity. Second, applicability. For validity, it is mostly in relation to the clarity or the quality of the document. Concerning applicability, it depends on the doctor's clinical judgment, whether considering the entire clinical setting, whether the situation applies. If it is a car crash and it is not cancer, of course, the conditions don't apply. So when an AMD is signed, the doctor must also consider whether a DNA CPR order should be made simultaneously. So that's how the doctor considers the applicability test. When the doctor thinks that it is not applicable yet, then the order will not be made. So some may worry if the patient's situation deteriorates rapidly, then without the DNA CPR order, what will happen? Well, as long as there is an AMD in place, the attending doctor must base the clinical judgment on the AMD. If the situations are still applicable, the doctor will have to follow the AMD, despite that a DNA CPR order has not been made yet. So like Dr. Sam mentioned, DNA CPR order is a piece of document which allay the concerns of the rescuers and the doctors in when making split-second decisions. It is also to for reassuring ambulance men and rescuers that CPR should not be performed. So when a patient's situation deteriorates quickly and is rushed to the ER, then the doctor must consider whether the directions made on the DNA CPR or the AMD is still apply. In other words, whether there is a rapid deterioration of the patient's situation. The patient's wish must be respected. Now, concerning applicability, it has everything to do with making clinical judgment. Dr. Jie, concerning whether it would cause confusion, like Reverend Kuhn said, although we are still scrutinizing the bill, the EHA has implemented the AMD mechanism since 2014. The principle behind that arrangement is very similar to the Blue Bill. We understand that in some cases, doctors may have varying opinions. So in a clinical setting, especially in a hospital setting, doctors work as a team. So through discussion, the doctors would reach a consensus. For emergency cases, say for example, the incidents occurred at night and there is just a junior doctor, then we must provide for a mechanism to allow the doctor to deviate from the order. However, there must be valid grounds and the doctor must be held accountable for their decision. If the doctor doesn't believe the patient is at a terminal stage, then they can deviate from the decision, but it must be a very careful decision. However, we must provide for a mechanism for the doctor to do so. Next, Ms. Carmen Khan. Thank you, Chair. I've heard the three members before me, so I would like to follow up on their questions. We must bear in mind the two important principles of the bill. One is easy making and careful making and easy revoking. So on expiry or on other conditions, the order should be revoked easily. So we would rather that a patient is saved to err on the safe side. We rely on the practical clinical decision made by the doctor. Now, the validity period for a DNA CPR order is 1 year. In a year's time, the situation of the patients may change a lot. The validating situations or conditions may no longer be there. So I trust the HA and the doctors. So from the perspective of doctors and the HA, and also from the perspective of law, I think the government has done a lot of simulations, and the Blue Bill is the result. So concerning Clause 36.2, When the attending doctor decides whether CPR should be performed, it may be so that the conditions are different from when the DNA CPR order was made. So AMD was made when the patient was still conscious. So for DNA CPR order, it is something that is decided for the patients by doctors. So AMD is something made voluntarily. So at the split second, when a split second decision is made, the doctors may decide to perform CPR to err on the safe side. So maybe in a very short period of time afterwards, the doctor may have to decide again whether CPR should be performed. So the split second decision may occur again further down the road. So I wonder if that would help us understand that this is still in the interest of the patients and we are still respecting. We are still respecting the wish of the patient. So I hope that after the passage of the bill, the HA would make sure that there is a consistency between the decisions made by the doctors. The attending doctor must understand that the signing RMP will not make the decision for them. So there must be consistency in terms of judgment calls. So I hope that answers the question made by the previous member. So before the bill, these situations have occurred, but there would not be such a certainty after the bill is enacted.
Well, second, after a year, the order would be expired. Well, I'd like to ask if there is a kind of a flagging kind of mechanism. Because for this order, in the future, will it become an electronic version or will it be in a paper form? The fire departments, fire officers might want to see the paper form order. So, shall we consider a kind of flagging or reminding mechanism so that the person involved would be reminded that the order is going to be expired soon so that he could renew it or do whatever follow-up actions that he deems fit? Thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Carmen Kan, for elaborating the views or the underlying principles of the order. Well, indeed, it's a two different concept about the revocation of the DNA CPR order and about the applicability of the order. So if attending CMP finds that the order is not applicable at a certain moment, it doesn't mean that the order would be revoked. It only means that it is under the clinical judgment of the attending CMP, attending RMP, that the order should not be applied. So this is point number one. For the other two suggestions, I think they are also very valuable. We have a 1.5 years consultation period. And if the bill is passed in the LegCo, we will then have 18 months of preparation on our part. We will work out the guidelines, the relevant guidelines for the medical professionals. We, of course, prefer to have a paper-based DNA CPR order, which would be more convenient for the fire officers and other attending carers to know the content of the order. but then on the other hand, it would be also be convenient to turn it into electronic form so that there could be a kind of flagging mechanism or reminder for the patient to renew the order, and also it would be more convenient for the attending doctors to know about the situation. So we would consider all these views as long as they are in the best interest of the patient. Thanks. Next, Ms. Lillian Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to ask a question on the revocation of the order. You mentioned that there should be two doctors co-signing the revocation of the order. Say, for instance, I'm a patient. I've already made the DNA CPR order previously. And if there are two doctors who think that they should have a different view, they should they want to revoke the order, but will they inform me in advance before they revoke the order? Well, if, for instance, I'm not aware that the order has been revoked. So, of course, this might be a rare case, but then I'm just trying to cite a very extreme example. Would that happen? That is, the patient would not be informed. Well, the second situation is that perhaps I received a notification telling me that the order is revoked. Will there be a mechanism for me to appeal against this decision? For instance, within 2 weeks, if I disagree with this clinical judgment of my doctors, I could make an appeal stating that I do not agree to the revocation, and I want to keep my DNA CPR order valid. And number three, for a lot of citizens, I think they would find it very troublesome to renew the order on time. This is a kind of added pressure on them. Or sometimes they may forget that the order has expired or is going to expire soon. Can we really make use of technology and send out e-notification to remind them to renew the order? And if in case they are out of town, what is the grace period after the expiration of the order? For renewal of the order, well, in general cases, the patient would be suffering from a very serious illness. So we expect that the patient, after signing the DNA CPR order, would go on live a normal life without clinical care. So normally, for these kind of patients who sign the DNA CPR order, they would be suffering from serious illness. So they may have to consult their doctors regularly after short intervals. So basically, the doctor would remind them about the expiry of the order, or to remind them to renew the order if necessary. So the medical doctors would be able to see this DNA CPR order record. And he should be able to remind his patient about it. Well, if the patient is not in a coma, then is it an AMD-based order? So perhaps he would state very clearly in the AMD that he would not want CPR to be performed on him. But then if another doctor evaluate the condition and finds that he is not terminally ill, and if the doctor feels that actually it's worth trying to treat this patient, of course this doctor has to consult with the patient. Well, he has to revoke the order. He has to sign his name on the form, on the revocation form. So definitely the doctor has to consult with the patient and explain to him and actually congratulate the patient, telling him that you're not terminally ill. We have new treatment methods coming out, and we think that it is worth trying to put treatment on you and then try to cure you. So the patient would then understand the new situation, and then he would consent to the revocation of his previous DNA CPR order. So I believe that the patient would definitely agree to this new arrangement. It is actually quite unlikely that the patient would refuse this new judgment or new proposed treatment of the RMP. So, well, in short, the RMP has to explain to the patient, telling him that you are not terminally ill now, we have new treatment, perhaps it's worth trying to revoke the order. Thank you, Chair. Well, I'll just try to cite some very extreme examples. For instance, we actually saw some patients suffering from stage 4 cancer would then survive longer than his doctor expected. So we do have faith in the medical profession, and we also believe that there should be a kind of safeguard to protect the interests of the patient. But then under very rare situation, for instance, if the order is expired, will there be any way that we do not need to remake the order, remake a new order? Can there be a grace period after the expiration of the order so that I don't need to go through all the processes again to make a new one? Dr. Zhe? Well, let me perhaps share with you about how we go about doing it in a clinical situation. Well, the patient, the terminally ill patient would be sent to some homes. The medical people would look at the DNA CPR order, and then when the patient consult them again, or if there are outreaching caretakers going to visit the patient, they would remind the patient about the expiry date of the order. Of course, we allow for some flexibility. Well, for instance, if the order is going to expire soon, we would ask the patient to come back to consult the doctor, even if it is not time for him to consult the doctor then. We would still ask him to come and then so that he could sign the order or renew the order. And if the patient is out of town, we do allow for some flexibility. And then upon his return, he could come to the hospital and the clinic to sign the order to renew the order again. Well, perhaps if that is the case, we should not regard it as a kind of flexible mechanism of flexibility or allowed. I think the frontline people might be, some of them may be rigid, saying that, well, this is already expired and you have to remake a new one. So I suggest that in the guidelines, perhaps you should state clearly that under certain circumstances, there should be some flexibility allowed. For instance, there could be a 3-month grace period or even 6-month grace period upon expiry, so that this patient could renew their order without going through all the process to make a new order again. Thank you. Let's go on. Thank you, Chair. Let's go back to C3344, Section 37, Notice of Order. When the person has notice of a DNA CPR order, when the person sees a validating copy of the order, so that would be a valid order. Clause 38. For the purpose of this ordinance, a person is not required to search the subject person of a DNA CPR order or the items that are carried by so as to ascertain whether the person carries a validating copy of the order. Well, put together both clauses, we could think of a situation when a fire officer see a person in arrest, then the officer would not need to go search to see whether that person in arrest has a validating copy of the order. Then the fire officer would have to make his own decision immediately at that point. point of time to save the person. So it says that he does not need to search the person or search the items that are carried by in order to ascertain whether there is a validating form or validating order. I understand that the HA would later on make some preparations. For instance, there would be some special kit so that a DNA CPR patient could put his order in the pocket, or so that the fire officer or other rescuer would be able to see this DNA CPR order very easily.
Moving on to the protection. Clause 39, interpretation. Just a moment, Ms. Lillian Kwok. Are your questions related to clauses 37 and 8? Thank you, Chair. I have some questions about the term validating copy. This is a new term which didn't exist before. So are you going to include the term validating copy in the interpretation? In the previous meeting, the administration indicated there would be an amendment moved. Thank you, Ms. Lillian Kwok. Having listened to members' views, we are going to change the Chinese term for validating copy from Yunhaomanbun to Kohaomanbun. Thank you. I just hope that it would be made clear in the interpretation part. There will be an amendment. Thank you. Please continue. Thank you, Chair. Just now, we were at Clause 39, interpretation for medical carer. It means a treatment provider and a rescuer. So it means the professional rescuers and also passerbys who are laymen. So the safeguard of protection applies to both laymen and medical professionals. The actual protection is in Clause 40. The design is like the safeguards provided in for AMD. Brackets 2 and brackets 4 of Clause 40. In performing CPR on the person in arrest, the medical carer does not incur any liability. So conditions include brackets 4. If the medical carer does not know of the existence of the order or know what the DNA CPR order is, or the medical carer is not satisfied that a DNA CPR order has been made for the person in arrest or the order is valid and applicable, then for these circumstances, a medical carer does not incur any liability for not performing CPR on the person in arrest. Brackets 5 and brackets 6. Circumstances where medical carer does not incur liability for not performing CPR on the person in arrest. The circumstances include where the medical carer honestly and reasonably believes that a DNA CPR order has been made for the person in arrest, and the medical carer honestly and reasonably believes that the order is valid and applicable. Then the carer may not perform CPR on the person in arrest. Now, there is a new condition, conditions specified in bracket 7. Now, the protection safeguards in DNA CPR are more comprehensive. So, subclause 7, there are conditions applying to situations where CPR is and is not performed. Now, as mentioned in the bill, we do appreciate rescuers to err on the safe side and perform CPR. For non-performance of CPR, the safeguard is higher. Now, for any conditions not met under subclause 7, the medical carer should perform CPR. So conditions include the medical carer has seen a document that appears to be a validating copy of a DNA CPR order or appears to show that the order in a prescribed form and has been duly completed, signed and dated and seen to show that the latest date specified has not passed, then in the absence of these, the medical carer can perform CPR. And none of the following circumstances comes to the attention of the medical carer. That's the making of the DNA CPR order was or may have been procured by wrongful means, or the order is or may have been revoked. So if the medical carer is aware that the DNA CPR order has been procured by wrongful means, or if the order has been revoked, then the medical carer should perform the CPR without incurring any legal liability. Now, subclause 3. There is no grounds to suspect that the there is no reason for the medical carer to determine that to suspect that the arrest is arises from an unnatural cause or an injury that is self-inflicted or inflicted by another person. So if there is no such suspicion, the medical carer should perform DNA CPR. So the three conditions mentioned above, all the above conditions must be met for the medical carer to decide not to perform CPR without incurring any liability. So in other words, the rescuers should look at the CPR and the DNA CPR order to see whether there are any suspicious circumstances or whether the DNA CPR order has expired. For instance, if the person in arrest is a male, but the name is a female name and all the dates are wrong, then the medical carer should save the person in arrest. So I will pause here. Ms. Carmen Khan. Thank you, Chair. On clause 40, this is a protection for the rescuer. The definition for rescuer is on the same page. So there is no distinction between treatment provider and rescuer. A rescuer may be a passerby. So my first question is, why there is not a distinction between rescuers and treatment providers? They are all grouped under the term medical carer. The term medical carer includes treatment provider and rescuer. So there is no separate standards. Second, concerning the threshold for the medical carer to satisfy the conditions in deciding to perform CPR, the requirement is more lenient. That is, the medical carer is not aware of the existence of a DNA CPR, or if the medical carer does not believe that the DNA CPR order is still valid and applicable, or that an order has been made. So this is easier. There is no mentioning of the term reasonably, honestly, and so on, because the decision to perform CPR is a split-second decision. Now, for deciding not to perform CPR, the bar is higher, comes with the terms honestly and reasonably believes that the DNA CPR order is effective. So can the administration explain the thinking behind the design? Thank you, Chair. In clause 39, we include both treatment providers and rescuers under the term medical carers. Now, for a person in arrest, it means that it means a person who is going to perform CPR on the person in arrest. For treatment provider, it must be a professional, like a registered Chinese medicine practitioner or doctor. So for medical carer, we haven't distinguished between whether the person is qualified or in a paid position. So as long as someone has received CPR training, even if the person is not a professional, they should be considered rescuer, and the protection should be extended to them as well. So as mentioned by Ms. Carmen Can, the threshold for the safeguard to kick in differs a bit for performing or not performing CPR. For deciding to perform CPR, the conditions are very direct. For a decision to not perform CPR, the medical carer must reasonably and honestly believe that the relevant conditions are met. So in deciding not to perform CPR, besides objectively considering that the order is still valid and applicable, the person must honestly and subjectively believe that the conditions are in force. So the threshold is higher. Thank you. Next, Mr. Tang Fei. Thank you, Chair. I agree that Clause 40 is necessary. Protection is needed. If it would incur legal liability, it would be stressful for the medical carers. Now, for patients with a DNA CPR order, if a medical carer still perform CPR on the patient, what will happen? There is an order in place, but the medical carer, against my wish, resuscitated me. So what legal liability will be incurred? So the policy intent of the bill is to spare medical carer from undue pressure on deciding to perform CPR. I understand that. Now, 4A2, a medical carer does not know what a DNA CPR order is. Now, according to Clause 39, medical carer includes treatment provider, that is, medical personnel. So usually, medical professionals will understand what a DNA CPR order is. This is already implemented in the HA. So the medical carers should have undergone CPR training, whether they are firemen or employed by the auxiliary medical services. They would have undergone CPR training. So no one would dare approach the person in arrest and perform CPR on them without having undergone some sort of training. So maybe this is confusing. Since the person has been trained, after the enactment of the ordinance, for rescuers who are firemen or uniformed groups, they would have received relevant guidelines. So the condition under 4A2, that the person does not know what a DNA CPR order is, should never be invoked. Thank you.
Mr. Lee? Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Tang, for your questions. Let me perhaps explain on the concept of the various terms. For this kind of clauses, they cover protection for the medical carer. That is, a person who is going to perform treatment on a person in arrest. We do not specify that that carer must be a person who has received professional training. So even for firemen or other kind of members of the uniformed groups, they could provide treatment or to rescue a person in arrest when necessary. So for this kind of people, they would need protection as well. So if they happen to come across a person in arrest, and if he performs a rescuing treatment to the person, and then afterwards, only afterwards, as he discovered that the person has a DNA CPR order, he could perhaps say that he does not know what a DNA CPR order is. Well, as mentioned by Mr. Tang, for people who have been professionally trained, of course, it would not be convincing to say that he does not know what a DNA CPR order is. But then he could also state that he has suspicion or he doubt whether that order is valid or not. So, after the enactment of the ordinance, we would also carry out promotion activities so that people would know what a DNA CPR order is. We have made a definition about what legal liability means. It means civil or criminal liability as well as professional misconduct. For instance, a person having a DNA CPR order with him, but if the rescuer continue to perform CPR on him, then the person in arrest after being rescued might sue that person for ignoring his order. But then if the rescuer could state this clause saying that perhaps he does not know what the order is, or he has reasonable doubt about the validity of the order, then this could be a kind of defense for himself. Let's continue. Let's go to C3350, clause 41. About protection of console operators at Fire Services Communications Center. The Fire Services Department has a kind of special service. That is, before the arrival of the ambulance, the Fire Service Communication Centers would call back the person who needs rescue, so that the operator could perhaps give some service to him, and then the operator could learn during his communication with the caller whether the caller has a copy of the DNA CPR or whether he is able to see a copy of that order. So this operator would not incur any liability for because the operator would not be able to see in person the copy of the DNA CPR. He would only consult or communicate with a caller and ask whether that caller can see a copy of the DNA CPR order. So we have the protection of this here in clause 41 for the console operators. So as long as the console operator honestly believes that the person in arrest has a copy of this the order, or the person seeking assistance. Well, has an order, so we give protection to the console operators through this clause. Well, I have a question. This is to protect the console operators at the fire services communication center. Say, for instance, we have some members, for instance, Mr. Wong Chun-shek, who has a professional qualification. For instance, his mom would maybe call him if she come across an emergency situation. So the caller may not be calling the fire services communication center. For instance, Mr. Wong's mom may be calling Mr. Wong to seek his professional advice. So I wonder if the protection could be a bit wider. That is, the protection should cover not just the console operators of the fire services communication center, but also other people, for instance, from the auxiliary medical services, Mr. Wong? Mr. Edmund Wong. Thank you, Chair. Well, thanks for citing me an example. Yes, indeed. In addition to the Fire Services Communication Center, we also have AMS. There are ambulance hotlines. Some people might want to call the AMS instead of 999 or the Fire Services Communication Center. So members of the AMS may perhaps give instruction to the caller. So will there be a post-dispatch advice? Would that also be applicable to AMS as well? If we can perhaps expand the protection scope a little bit at this stage, then we'll be able to cover these people, for instance, members of the AMS, so as to avoid amending the ordinance in the future to cover them. And as the chair pointed out just now, whether my mom would call me, yes, indeed, that might happen. There might be large-scale operations. There are interdepartmental events, we would have a kind of on-site operation center to coordinate the dispatch of personnel, the ambulances, etc. So let's say, for example, is the Standard Chartered Bank Marathon. Would that be covered as well? For instance, the marshal on site, would he be protected under this clause? Well, this could be possible. So I think this clause, if it covers only the console operators at Fire Services Communications Center, then I think there are a lot of other sectors or other people who may be doing the same work. They may not be able to enjoy this kind of legal protection. So I think this is a very reasonable point raised by the chair. Perhaps the administration could go back and reconsider to see whether this clause could be expanded a little bit so as to widen its protection scope. Well, if necessary, then you could forward your proposed amendment to us later. Ms. Carmen Ken? Well, I heard your views, the views raised just now. I think we have to reconsider about the applicability of DNA CPR, because in Clause 25, there is mentioned about different kinds of DNA CPR orders. For AMD-based order, it would be made by a person who is mentally capable. So there would be a kind of DNA CPR order that is AMD-based. So that would not be covered or by the console operators. They might be, for instance, minors or MIP, people or persons who are mentally incapable. Perhaps we should consider whether we should cover these scenarios as well. So there could be three types of DNA CPR. The caller may be calling not just the console operators of the Fire Services Communication Center. He could be calling different personnel or different auxiliary services as well. Because Clause 41 mentions only about the console operators at FSD. The operator might ask the caller whether he could see a copy of the DNA CPR with the person in arrest. And then, based on the reply of the caller, the console operator would then give suggestions accordingly. And this clause, Clause 41, is to protect these operators. So I think we have to reconsider whether the scope is too narrow or whether we should expand it to cover other personnel. We really have to reconsider three different types of DNA CPR orders. Who would be receiving the calls and who would be in a position to provide instructions or suggestions, professional instructions to the caller? Yes, I think the administration could bring this back and reconsider it a bit more. Chair, I think the protection is basically provided in Clause 40. That is, no matter whether the medical carer is a public officer or not, it could be a layman, a layperson. So this clause, Clause 40, is to protect all these carers. We also have Clause 41, particularly for the protection of the FSC, Fire Services Communication Center. But we heard your views, members, and we would reconsider it later on. Chair, I do have a point to make. The carer is the person who is in the at the spot, who would be providing treatment or care to the person. And here we talk about the communication between the caller and the console operators. It is through the phone. So I do agree that we should expand the protection scope, especially for people providing off-site suggestions to the caller. When you look at Clause 41, it is to protect the console operators at the Fire Services Communication Center. So the console operator, after receiving a call from a caller, he would then communicate with the caller. Well, actually, I don't understand how a medical carer could honestly understand whether the order is valid or applicable. How do the caller and the medical carer communicate? Is it only through a phone conversation and it's only verbal communication? Well, so would that be reliable?
The caller.
Thank you, Chair. The protection offered under Clause 41 is limited to console operators at Fire Services Communications Center. the console operators have received professional training. So from what they hear, the console operators can reasonably give professional reply. It is true that they have no direct access to what's happening at the scene. They can only base their advice or reply on what they hear. On that basis, we are providing them with legal safeguards. So the protection offered, I mean the reasonableness and mentioned in clause 40 and 41 are different. The level of reasonableness would differ based on whether the medical carer can see what's actually happening at the scene. Now, clause 40, bracket 7. The medical carer is reasonably satisfied that a medical carer of the person in arrest has, during the episode of care, seen a document. So I highlight the word seen.
Person in arrest has seen a document that appears to be a DNA CPR.
So in the English text, it is a medical carer. So it doesn't just refer to an individual carer. It can mean a team of carers. So that covers the situation the member mentioned, that it is a joint operation comprising several departments. So that's how the protection will operate. So considering the differences between clauses 40 and 41, in clause 41, we are basing the test of reasonableness on what the console operators hear on the phone. So what about people other than console operators at FSD? Now, the console operators have undergone professional training to provide rescue services. So compared with a layman who has professional knowledge, whom I called for advice, their capacity is different from a console operator working at the communications center. So there are other organizations providing post-dispatch advice and guidelines, so we will review the situation and consider whether amendments are needed. Chair, whether they are the medical carers or the console operators, to enjoy the highest safeguard, they need to see with their own eyes the existence of the DNA CPR order. In both clauses 40 and 41, both the console operators and the medical carers need to honestly and genuinely believe the existence of the DNA CPR order. They need to make their own observations and judgments on the authenticity of the documents. They have to bear a certain extent of legal liability. Dr. David Lam, thank you, Chair. Clause 41, protection of console operators at Fire Services Communications Center. It only protects the console operators on whether CPR is performed and on whether the DNA CPR order is valid. It does not cover the advice given by the operators to the medical carers on how to perform the CPR or how the person in arrest is resuscitated. So it is not necessary that the console operators have undergone professional training because they are just making the judgments by the documents. Now, I think the protection doesn't extend to paramedics. You call a person and asking the person to judge for you whether the DNA CPR order is effective. That's all. So if that's the case, I agree that not just anyone can tell you if the DNA CPR order is valid. So it is natural to extend the protection only to console operators as the FSD. But there are some organizations which are also familiar with DNA CPR order. For example, auxiliary medical forces. So can you consider extending the protection to these auxiliary medical organizations, just on these, on helping the caller to distinguish the authenticity of the DNA CPR order? So on the schedule, the console operators at FSD are included, but you may consider including other organizations on the schedule. Thank you. We will have a discussion with other heads of departments to see whether the protection should be extended. Mr. Edmund Wong, now, since the government has promised to review the mechanism, I will not put my further question because we are encouraging all hands, everyone in society, to help save lives and to respect patients' will. Now, if only console operators at FSD are included, it is not ideal. As mentioned by the chair, now, if someone knows me, then if my mother suffers from a fall, they won't call the emergency services immediately. They would call me first. So how do we protect these so-called Good Samaritans? I think we have had a similar debate many years ago in Leshko. So we have to extend the protection to well-intended parties who have no wish to harm the patient. By that, we can encourage more people to help save lives. This is something the international community is promoting as well. If we draw the scope of protection too narrowly, to protect only console operators as FSD, then it is not ideal. Thank you. Next, Clause 42. Clause 42, page C3352 in the Chinese text. Certain civil liabilities not affected by sections 40 and 41. Brackets 1. Section 40 or Clause 40 covers medical care. Now, if a third person would have been civilly liable for the medical carers performing or not performing CPR on the person in interest, then the subsection does not affect the liability of the third person. Brackets 2, Clause 41, Subclause 2, the protection only applies to the fire services department's console operators, so it does not affect the civil liability of the government for the response described in Clause 41. Clause 43. It is about the burden and standard of proof in legal proceedings or criminal proceedings. A person who seeks to rely on subsection 2 or 5 of section 40 in any criminal proceedings has the burden of establishing that there was any of the circumstances mentioned in that subsection. So that's the usual standard of or burden of proof. Now C3356, part 4, offences in relation to the bill. We are setting out some offences and the punishment. I will pause here. Ms. Carmen Kan. Thank you, Chair. I would like to go back to Clause 42. A third person's legal liability. Now, section or clause 42, subclause 2, it says (42)(1) concerning protection for medical carers or rescuers, it does not affect the liability of the third person. So does a third person include the employer? Now, the incidents may occur at in the office setting. So from a civil liability perspective, the third party, including an employer, may have to bear liability for the employee. It will not be exempted unless the party we are talking about is the government. PAS, thank you, Chair. I will give a brief reply and then invite the DOJ to explain further. Now, 41, subclause 2 or 5, this is about the third party liability. So besides the government, it also includes employers in general. Subclause 2. Subclause 2 only applies to the HASAR government. So section 41(2) mentioned in subclause 2 of 42 relates to consul operators at fire services communication center. So they must be government employees. So for (1), it extends to all third parties besides the HASAR government. So it includes all employers besides the HASAR government. DOJ, the administration's understanding is correct. Ms. Carmen Kan. So clause 42, subclause 2, I only understand now that it only applies to consul operators of FSD. So if there is an amendment in clause 41, subclause 2, then naturally clause 42 would be amended as well. So concerning the vicarious liability borne by the employer, it will not be waived. In a school setting, on deciding whether to perform CPR on a teacher, the medical carer's own liability would be waived. There are a number of tests in subsequent clauses and so on. So what's your consideration? The school's liability will not be waived. A third party can also mean operator of a shopping mall. So the medical carer's own liability is waived. But what about the third party? In accordance with the law, the civil liability borne by the third party is not waived. I stress civil here, not criminal liability. So what's the consideration behind?
Let me try to explain, and perhaps colleague from the DOJ could supplement. Well, talking about liability, it depends on the relationship between the employer and the employee. The carrier's liability. Well, for instance, a rescuer or the carer could be a hospital or a professional organization. If it has to get rid of the carrier's liability, it would have to provide evidence showing that it has given necessary guidelines and also training to its employees so that they would understand what a DNA CPAR order is. Well, for shopping malls and schools, they are not professional medical institutions, so the kind of training they should provide to their employees would not be medical based, and the considerations would be different. Any supplement from DOJ? Well, Chairman, this is a kind of general principle. Well, under some circumstances, if a person or the carer does not provide or does not perform CPR to the person in arrest, or if according to the DNA CPR order, he does not provide CPR, then we have to understand that the decision is made by the person at the spot based on what he see, what he honestly and reasonably believe that whether the person in arrest has a DNA CPR order. So for the employer, usually the employer is in a better position to seek insurance coverage to take care of this kind of situation. So we believe that the employer would be in a better position. As for the employees, they might not have this kind of advantage. So we think that we should provide protection to the employees. Well, Chairman, well, I think this point should be more, it should be explained clearer in the text. Under the common law, if this is a legal principle, then, well, in other words, I think we should explain more clearly that this is also the case under the common law. So for the frontline people, such as the PE teachers, or the employees in the shopping malls, that we provide some kind of relief to them. But for the schools and for the shopping malls or the employers, these are the third parties who might be affected. So we have to state very clearly that about the responsibility of this third person. Well, of course, the objective is to provide protection to the victim or to the person who is disadvantaged. So, well, I'm not sure if insurance would cover this kind of situation. We have to state, for instance, whether this is already prevalent in the common law. And we should delineate it more clearly in our ordinance. Well, Chairman, we do understand the the vicarious liability of the employers prevents under the common law. What we're doing here is to set down the status or the of the DNA CPR order. So what we have to do is to state the liability or the results of a person respecting the DNA CPR order or a person who make a decision not to follow the DNA CPR order. We have to state who will be exempted or who would not be liable. All right, if there are no further questions, let's go on. Clause 44. Thank you, Chair. Now we are in part 4, offenses. First, interpretation of terms, interpretation of benefit. It means any financial or proprietary gain, whether temporary or permanent, and also includes such a gain by keeping what one has, as well as such a gain by getting what one has not. Damage is a relation to a thing, includes deface, mutilate, obliterate, and destroy the thing. Instruction means instruction in advance medical directive. That is, a person is not to be subjected to any life-sustaining treatment. And for specified instrument, it means an advanced medical directive or a DNA CPR order that is AMD-based. And instruction means an instruction in advance medical directive. That is, a person is not to be subjected to any life-sustaining treatment specified in the instruction. Clause 45, offense to obstruct following of instruction in advance medical directive. A person, if he knows that another person has a DNA CPR order, and the instruction in the order is valid and applicable, and if that person willfully obstructs a treatment provider of the person B in following the instruction, then this person A would commit an offense. So this kind of obstruction it's not verbal. This is a kind to obstruct a treatment providing to the person in need of the treatment. So the person committing this offense would be liable on conviction to a fine at level 5 and to imprisonment for 6 months. For DNA CPR order, it is to not to perform CPR, so it is not an offense to obstruct a person of not performing CPR on another person. So it is basically just obstructing a person in performing AMD on another person. For a bracket 3, it says that a person who honestly and reasonably believe that the instruction was not valid or not applicable, then it could be a defense for that person. I'll stop here to see if there are any questions. If not, our chairman. Yes, Ms. Carmen Ken. I think it's difficult to understand the concept. The AMD directive is not to perform CPR, right? How do you obstruct a person of not performing CPR on another person? How do we understand clause 45, bracket 1, bracket C? How do you obstruct a person following the instruction? I don't understand. How would it happen? Well, Chairman, we're talking about the obstruction to follow the instruction. So the instruction is to provide life-sustaining treatment or not to receive life-sustaining treatment. For instance, a patient receiving a kind of care, medical care, for instance, kind of intubation. So if you obstruct the withdrawal of LST, then this is a kind of obstruction. To obstruct is withdrawal. Okay, please continue. Clause 46. Thank you, Chair. It's C3361 on the English version. Clause 46 and 47 are quite similar. Both offenses are about damaging documents relating to specified instrument. Well, these documents shows the intention or the views, the will of the patient. So without the consent of the individual who made the instruction, if another person damaged the validating copy of that instrument, then he would be committing an offense. That means a person who has signed a document stating that he does not wish to receive life-sustaining treatment, then if you damage that copy, then that means the patient would be receiving the kind of life-sustaining treatment. Then the person who damaged the copy of the instrument would have committed an offense. Well, a person who commits such an offense would be liable on conviction to a fine at level 5 and imprisonment for 6 months. Well, if the person intends to extend or to jeopardize the health of the individual, then he would also have committed an offense. Under 2 bracket B, we would add the element of a person ignoring the content of the instrument. So, because in doing so, he would prolong the suffering of the individual who is covered by the instrument. For clause 47, it is about a revoked DNA CPR order. That is, the person wants to continue to receive life-sustaining treatment. However, if that record is damaged, then the person would not be able to receive LSTs, so the person would suffer. So this offense would be more serious than that covered in clause 46. So a person who commits such an offense would be liable on indictment to imprisonment for 10 years. And if that damaging of the record would jeopardize the health of the individual who is covered by the instrument, or if that person would obtain any benefit for himself or another person, then he would be liable on conviction on indictment to imprisonment for 14 years. Right, if Deputy Secretary, if you could cover C3368, so that we could be more complete in our scrutiny of the clauses. Shall we extend the meeting for 15 more minutes? Thanks.
Thank you. Clause 48. Also, a defense for offenses. A person charged with an offense who honestly and reasonably believed that the validating copy of the specified instrument or the record of revocation of the specified instrument was not needed for any purpose relating to the operation of this ordinance. So the person might have heard that the document has been revoked, so there is no need to maintain the record, so it was destroyed. So if that's the case, if that's the honest belief of the person, then it would be a defense. Subdivision 3, false or misleading representation. Whether it is made for obstructing the compliance or inducing or causing the compliance of causing the non-compliance of the instrument. So advanced decision instrument covers AMD-based DNA CPR orders and non-AMD-based DNA CPR orders. In the context of Clause 50, concerning obstruction of CPR, obstruction of DNA CPR orders, that is causing CPR to be performed on the patient against the will of the patient. If a person knowingly makes to another person a false or misleading representation with the intent to prevent the following of an instruction in an advanced medical directive or a DNA CPR order, it would be an offense, and the person would be subject to a fine at level 5 and imprisonment for 6 months. It is identical to the punishments in the previous clause. Now, another more serious situation is causing an obstruction to the compliance, the following of the order, with intent to prevent the following of the instruction, to prolong the suffering of the third person or obtain any benefits for the person. It is a more serious case, so the punishment is pitched at imprisonment of 3 years. Clause 51, offense of making false or misleading representation to procure compliance with advanced decision instruments. So maybe the advanced decision instrument is already revoked or no longer valid. So the person makes false or misleading representation to procure compliance with the instrument, causing the patient's death. So the proposed punishment is 10 years imprisonment. If there is also the intent to jeopardize the health of the third person or obtain any benefits for the person in question, then the punishment would be pitched at 14 years imprisonment. Ms. Carmen Khan. Thank you, Chair. I would like to seek clarification on the wording in Clause 50, Subclause 2C, Roman number 2, capital A, prolong the suffering of the third person. So for this scenario, the context of the clause is prevents the compliance with advanced decision instruments, in other words, life-sustaining treatment is provided to the patient. So the wording here is prolonging the suffering of the third person. So compared with the subsequent clause, it is about procuring compliance with the advanced decision instrument. So the wording used is jeopardizing the health of the third person. Why is this so? The intents are different. So the wordings are also different. The wording in Clause 51 is jeopardizing the health of the third person. For Clause 50, it is prolonging the suffering of the third person. So procuring compliance means that the patients may die in the end. Is that why the wordings are different? Now, in the simplest terms, Clause 50, the result is the patient lives. Clause 51, the patient dies. That's why Clause 50, there is life-sustaining treatment and the patient survives. However, and the suffering is prolonged. Now, Clause 51, very likely the patient would die in the end. Well, not necessarily so, but life-sustaining treatment is not being provided. So we use the wording jeopardizing the health of the third person. So like Ms. Carmen Can said, the scenarios are different. Ms. Lillian Kwok, thank you. So Ms. Carmen Can asked about the sentence jeopardizing the health of the third person. So shouldn't you say jeopardizing the health or life of the third person to make the distinction clearer? That's my suggestion. Also, I raised a similar question on C3342 in the Chinese text. I can't locate the page. Anyway, it's about the offense, the liability. If a third party's health is jeopardized, or if there is an intent, now if there is a misrepresentation and so on, it is criminal offense. Now what if a witness or a doctor discovers something? Do they have the liability to report it or raise it? If they are aware of such a situation, but they decide not to report the case, so does that amount to the liability, similar to those in procuring compliance or preventing compliance or delaying compliance and so on? So if doctors or witnesses are made aware of this situation, do they have the liability to report the case or raise the issue? Mr. Lee? Thank you, Chair. This is an offense, and offense is something that we hate to see. So all along, the bill covers AMD only. So the more important part of the issue is to have a well-formulated, advanced health plan or advanced medical plan. So during the advanced medical planning stage, relatives or the patients can raise various issues with the doctors. So after all the process, if, say, a family member or a doctor decides to damage the AMD or DNA CPR or make false representation to procure compliance or non-compliance of the AMD, that is a very egregious offense. So that is a very extreme scenario. If that's the case, the entire medical team and other family members should be aware of such an offense. So for these scenarios, I think the doctors and the family members would consider whether a report should be made to the police. But of course, if it comes to that stage, it would be very egregious. So everything should have been prepared in advance during the advanced medical planning stage. I understand that my question is about a very extreme scenario, but we can't rule out the possibility. Medical professionals are supposed to be neutral in helping the patient. If they discover similar situations and there is no explicitly set out responsibility to report the case in the bill, then it would be not ideal. So you should have set it out clearly. Dr. Jay? Dr. Doris Jay. Thank you. Concerning the professional guidelines, it is already specified in one of the guidelines. If medical professionals suspect foul play, they should report the case to their supervisors and decide on the next step. So this already exists in the current guidelines. But I think this just covers medical professionals. Witnesses are also a third party, so maybe you should consider including this requirement in the bill. Any stakeholders involved should be required to report a case when they discover foul play. Ms. Carmen Kan. Chair, I think we have been moving quite fast in this part, but I think part three involves offense. And these are similar offenses compared with part two. Now, in part three or part two, there is a defense in clause 48. That is, if for damaging, invalidating copy, or destroying records. In clause 48, there is a defense. As long as the person honestly and reasonably believed that the validating copy or the specified instruments or record are no longer needed, then it would be a defense. However, in subdivision 3, it involves false or misleading representation. The consequence is much more dire. So I think publicity is very important. Intent and state of mind is at stake here. So whether the false or misleading representation arises from the emotional attachment with the patient, or whether there is an intent to obtain benefit, say in estate or when the interested party who gets their share in the estate. So there are a lot of possible scenarios in terms of false or misleading representation. I think during the 18 months transitional period, we need to conduct a wide publicity campaign. Even if the misleading representation is made based on emotional attachments with the patient, or whether there is an intent to bring about harm to the patient, we need to conduct a widespread publicity campaign because it will come with a punishment. You can't neglect the will of the patient simply because of your emotional attachment with the patient. And also, the punishment depends on whether you have an intent to obtain benefits. This is a serious thing, and we need to conduct proper education on the matter. Ms. Carmen Can, sorry, it is 1 p.m. I need to exercise my power to further extend the meeting. If there is no objection, we will seek to complete part four. Mr. Lee.
Once again, I'd like to thank Ms. Can for her suggestions. Well, indeed, one of the underlying principles of the bill is to better protect the patient and also to make sure that his will is respected. We mentioned time and again that when a patient made an AMD or made a DNA CPR order, these reflect the will of or the wish of the patient. So we hope that his wish could be respected under all circumstances. So no matter whether it's a kind of emotional attachment of his family members or some ill plans of the family members involving properties, we want to make sure that the actual wish of the patient could be respected and being acted accordingly. We will try to do better preparation in the 18 months following the enactment of the bill and also conduct promotion and publicity so that people would thoroughly understand the objective of this kind of instructions. And we also mentioned about the copies of the instrument. These would also be valid. The person who made the order could make different copies and distribute the copies to his family members so as to make sure that his family members understand his wish. But if that family member honestly believed that the copy would not be needed under other circumstances and destroy the copy, then he would not be liable as long as he can prove that he honestly believed that these are just copies and it would not be useful in the future. Well, if there are false or misleading representation, it could become an offense. Even if based on some emotional attachment, false or misleading representation would also be an offense. Yes, Ms. Khan just mentioned that it could be because of emotional attachment. Some people or family members of the patient might think that this would not be an offense. So we hope that the administration within the 18 months of promotion and publicity, you would step up with your promotion and also explain more clearly about this point. Yes, you have to state very clearly that even if it's because of your emotional attachment to the patient, if you make false or misleading representation, it will still be an offense and it would not be a defense for yourself. All right. Well, if members have any further questions about the content of the clauses that we have covered, you could raise them before our next meeting. So we will stop here. We will start our scrutiny on part five at our next meeting. Next agenda item is AOB. We do not have any item under AOB. The meeting is adjourned. Once again, thank you very much for your attendance.